Milton said that photography is a language, and like any spoken, written language, can describe a tremendous number of things, situations, styles, and so on. In my own work, I would classify myself as both professional and amateur, because the work does not reflect the true amateur character. It's usually rather dead and lifeless, empty of feeling or spirit. The word amateur comes from basic terms meaning love or loving, and it is perfectly possible for the most serious professional photographer to be also an amateur in the true meaning of the word. I do a great deal of writing, both of articles and reports, and I have a lot of correspondence with other photographers who are constantly writing in on all kinds of matters, technical and aesthetic, and have a lot of general correspondence. I find myself doing a great deal of work at the typewriter, which annoys my friends and wears out the typewriter ribbons, but as a rule, most of the work is all part of the whole cloth. You, in any art, you're in up to your ears, and I would say that's my case. The division of time in photography is rather simply stated that perhaps 3/4 of the time is more or less concerned with studying the project and trying to visualize the images and their functions. And what is quite surprising to many people, there's not too much time spent in actual shooting. We, of course, it depends on the type of work that news people undoubtedly spend most of their time in the field, whereas serious professionals, especially in advertising, may spend an enormous amount of consultation with the agents and the art directors and stylists and so on. But in my particular case, I would say that about 75% is thinking and planning, and 25% is actual shooting and lab work. And of course, added to that as a further complication is the amount of time spent in travel. I do very little regular commercial work, but I do recall my first experience, which was rather remarkable, as it was the first example I had ever come across of deception by convention. The problem was to photograph raisin bread, and of course to show the luscious quality of the glistening raisins. The client brought loaves of very fine-grained sandwich bread and loaves of ordinary raisin bread, and with tweezers extracted little pieces of the dough from the cut surface of the sandwich bread and carefully inserted the raisins, which he had plucked from the slices of raisin bread. Now, this was rather remarkable to me because this was obviously impossible to bake bread with raisins in it and not get the, I understand they call the steam holes, which come from the heated moisture in the raisins. And it was even more astonishing that this kind of work would have been demanded by the client, because this picture was going into a baker's journal, and you could assume that, one would assume that bakers would know what raisin bread would really look like. I think the term professional covers all of us who make our living from the practice of photography.
This is, of course, a professional photograph, as is this photograph of smoke crystals, one of a series taken with the aid of the electron microscope.
I myself, while I find them extraordinarily interesting, am not always able to read in any particular aesthetic significance, because the photographs are made without selection or control.
This too is a professional photograph made on assignment by Dorothea Lange.
Dorothea Lange is a very remarkable artist, and she is able to combine the external and the internal event to a very poignant, moving degree, and her work, while superficially is documentary in character, it also contains a great and deep poetic quality.
A professional photograph of yet a different kind, a photograph of the Pleiades.
Some of the astronomical photographs are amazingly exciting, but again, it is something that is beyond the real control of the operator in the strict sense of the term.
And finally, a professional photograph taken on assignment for Life magazine, a photograph from Eugene Smith's Nurse Midwife series.
Eugene Smith's Spanish Village series and his Midwife series are, in my opinion, great milestones in the development of photography.
Adams is called the likeness business to what he has termed environmental portraiture. Here, our subject for a portrait is Julie Orensky, a young San Francisco artist in the non-objective idiom.
I don't do very much portraiture, but when I do work with a subject, I'm primarily interested in the reaction that I have from that subject at that particular time. I don't have any formula that I'm conscious of. I would like to treat every subject as a completely individual case in every respect. One of the most important aspects of portrait photography is what I would call the environmental portrait, which doesn't mean that a lawyer is photographed in front of law books or a chemist in a chemical laboratory, but that the subject is photographed in an environment which conveys a mood or reinforces a mood specifically related to that particular person, and that is instinctively determined by the photographer. It's not a thing that you can celebrate on. It's all part of the what we call the equivalent statement. Portraiture to me is a very specific branch of photography, a rather dangerous one to monkey with unless you really have the ability to handle people in a creative and constructive way. To me, a portrait is much more than a likeness, and yet at the same time, I do not feel justified in literally directing the subject into attitudes and expressions which I would think would be appropriate. I think it is the obligation of the photographer to reveal the subject in terms of the subject himself. We recognize people not only by the facial configuration, but the both the face and the personality through time. And that is why the so-called candid photograph, which is merely an aspect of a person in a short slice of time, may be either a caricature or an exaggeration or merely nothing as far as the basic revelation of that person's character is concerned. And in my own work, I frankly confess that I prefer portraiture almost on the basis of sculpture. And what I mean by that is that the person's face in repose will very often reveal far more of the character and the individuality of the person than any moment of time or any slice of time taken out of this person's configurations in movement, if we can use that term. The concept of photography as based on pre-visualization of the image carries through all branches of the work. You will have a certain visualization problem of landscape, and then of course when you get to portraiture, you have the personality problem entering in. You can see the ideal photograph in your mind's eye, but you have the expression of your subject to contend with. You have to accept the constantly changing mood and aspect of the subject. But I would say on the whole, it would be rather futile to attempt an interpretive photograph without really knowing what you expected to get. And you have a higher percentage of failure with portraiture due to conditions entirely within the subject. But all aspects of any art are, of course, if satisfactorily carried through, are always carried to the highest degree that anyone can take them. And we really can't be careless at any time and at any place. We very often find a competition in one person of two major directions in photography. One is a purely creative, and the other is that of the expedience, the necessity to produce images to satisfy clients. However, any balanced worker will realize that in both cases, the craft must be of as high order as possible, and certain adaptation must be made. Here in San Francisco, we have an extraordinarily capable, gifted, professional, and commercial photographer, Mr. Milton Halberstadt, who is very well trained in the Bauhaus approach, who has an enormous inventive capacity and a magnificent and flexible technique. Advertising photography is extremely complex. It has many varied functions. It is designed not to mislead, although, of course, some photographs do, and I think intentionally. It is primarily, to my mind, designed to clarify and to convince. And there are many times when certain manipulations of the subject and of lighting and compositional aspects have to be applied in order to create a simulation of reality. And one of the most important differences in this field of professional photography lies in the fact that we have to construct or contrive scenes and subjects in order to convey the essential points which the client wishes the photograph to convey to the spectator. There is another difference between the professional and the advanced amateur, which is this, that the professional has to adapt himself to the problems and the projects and functions of his client. He has to be able to handle the various assignments that come to him, whereas the more or less independent amateur will pick and choose with much more personal satisfaction and intensity. And that is why it is very hard sometimes for people who have practiced and worked entirely in the creative field, much as easel painters do, to adapt themselves to any externally presented problem. The photography of nature, unmanipulated and simple, is one thing. But in all kinds of advertising, photography, fashion, food, so on, we do have problems of subject organization. I use the word contrivance here not as a negative term, but as a term which covers the building of sets, the use of varied lighting facilities, the preparation of models, and so on. I think that most of this work represents construction and creation outside of the camera. And the camera then records what the photographer and the artist have produced before it. And that's a very different concept from the creation of important and moving images entirely within the camera, which is one must work with from nature or from simple portraiture. Any creative photographer in any field over the years develops a vast resource of experience which is safely tucked away in his subconscious and drawn upon when required. I like to think of this resource in the term as being compared to actual capital, and at any moment when a picture problem presents itself, he draws upon not the capital but the let's call the interest from this vast resource. And then he puts back into his resource fund this new and added experience. It's very much like a musician. He is performing a masterwork of great complexity on the piano, for example, and he cannot possibly think of every note or even of every phrase as a disjointed thing. It's a sum total expression of a basic concept. And we have this same problem in photography, which, of course, only experience can solve. That is, the fund, the resource in everyone's mind and personality, which can be drawn upon to supply the aesthetic and craft capabilities at any given moment for any given subject. What we call industrial photography is, of course, a branch of professional photography, and it includes everything from the very large down to the very small in this mechanical civilization, and even such spectacular, now obsolete, objects as this mechanical brain from an old B-17 fire control unit will present unlimited possibilities in composition, resolution of the shapes and the forms and the various metallic textures. I had a recent assignment to do some photographs of a rather spectacular new power plant. Of course, the ideal approach would be to spend quite a little time in making a thorough survey, allowing your unconscious mind to help you in this visualization of the pictures. But in this particular case, there was not very much time, and I had to make a rather quick survey. And of course, as in most big factories and plants and machinery, there's vast chaos. The forms are there, very interesting, exciting, vital forms, but it's very difficult to isolate them from a very complex, sometimes rather crummy background and environment. The client in industrial photography thinks he knows what he wants, but it is very hard for a non-photographer to actually visualize a photograph. And it's the job of the photographer to more or less and in a kindly way, convince the client that he himself must trust the photographer to develop the theme once the theme is given him. It is very difficult, if not impossible, for the client to photograph any industrial scene or any, in any professional field without some kind of a program. There's kind of a futility in merely making a lot of photographs which the client says he'll put together after the photographs are made. In architecture, where an architect would be requested to design a house without any knowledge of the site or of the function of the structure or the character of the people who are to live in it. So a mixed group of photographs of any one subject may be brilliantly edited and result in a good, exciting presentation. But I believe it would be accepted by all that a well-studied and well-based advanced program would be the most efficient, most satisfactory approach in the long run. In this particular case, I concentrated on one of the large stacks and made quite a symmetrical picture, trusting to the configurations of the sky behind it to add certain compositional variety. We can have such things as asymmetry within a basic symmetrical structure, and sometimes we achieve a strong and powerful effect through a very carefully controlled symmetry, unsymmetrical accents. I think it is a common concept among the general public that photo documentation, or documentary photography, as sometimes called, is confined to aspects of human misery. This probably stems from photography's inherent capacity to treat nostalgia as one of the dominant conditions. There's one basic problem which I think affects all photographers, and it has something to do with the privacy of the subject. Yet some of the most moving photographs ever made have been pictures made entirely unbeknown by the subject. The subject was under conditions of intense emotional stress. But as long as there was a certain dignity and reality and truth involved in it, I believe we're very justified in making such documentary images. Now, to my mind, one of the very greatest photographers of our time. He can be called a photojournalist. He might want to be called a photodocumentarist, or he might merely want to be called a photographer. But I'm referring to Gene Smith, whose incredible series of the Spanish Village and of the Midwife are absolutely unsurpassed in photography, any time and of any category.
Gene Smith went to South Carolina to record the story of a dedicated nurse and midwife, Maud Callan. Mrs. Callan drives 36,000 miles each year within her county, acting as doctor, dietitian, diagnostician, and friend to some 10,000 people. Maud's working day lasts 12 to 16 hours. The only lie she permits herself is her determined statement that she is not tired. In Berkeley County, South Carolina, on the edge of Hell Hole Swamp, a new baby is expected. The child will need a warm crib. Bottles of hot water wrapped in clean rags will do quite well. Preparations for birth are simple. The doctor is not a doctor, but a nurse midwife, Maud Callan, called to a cabin near Pineville late at night. The mother, Alice, has been in labor for some hours, but is resting now. Nurse Maud has boiling water, clean rags, and Lysol ready. She watches. She waits. Alice awakens and listens to the heartbeat of her unborn child. Labor starts again. Alice begins to cry. Her cries grow stronger, and soon a child is born. Begun. Puddles in the road outside reflect the dull sky.
Professional photography, in any of its forms, has a vital part to play in our culture, for essentially it is a language to be spoken with clarity, expression, and meaning. Its most important criterion is integrity.
National Educational Television.